رأيت الذنوب تميت القلوب ويقطعها الظلم إنها وترك الذنوب حياة القلوب وخير لنفسك عصيانها. رأيت الذنوب تميت القلوب ويتبعها الذل إدمانها وترك الذنوب حياة القلوب وخير لنفسك عصيانها.
الحمد لله، نحمده ونستغفره ونستعينه ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه، ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله أرسله بالحق بشيرًا ونذيرًا بين يدي الساعة، صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليمًا كثيرًا. أما بعد، عباد الله، أوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله، فإن الله يأمر بذلك قائلا: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. ويقول تبارك وتعالى: قل بفضل الله وبرحمته فبذلك فليفرحوا هو خير مما يجمعون. وعن أبي حازم عن سهل بن سعد رضي الله عنه أنه قال: إنا كنا نفرح بيوم الجمعة، كانت لنا عجوز تأخذ من أصول سلق لنا، كنا نغرسه في أرابيعنا فنجعله في قدر لها، أو فتجعله في قدر لها فتجعل فيه حبات من شعير، لا أعلم إلا أنه قال: ليس فيه شحم ولا دك ولا ودك، فإذا صلينا الجمعة زرناها فقربته إلينا، فكنا نفرح بيوم الجمعة من أجل ذلك، وما كنا نتغدى ولا نقيل إلا بعد الجمعة. My brothers and sisters, first and foremost, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept your fast in the Mubarak month of Ramadan. Indeed, it is a great bounty and a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when He allows us to fast in the month of Ramadan. It is a month that is blessed, in which, as you know, there is a great night, the night of Qadr. So we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving us the opportunity. It is indeed an opportunity to fast in the month of Ramadan, to read the Quran, to stand up in Qiyam. And this is a most wonderful ni'mah, a most wonderful bounty that Allah ta'ala bestowed upon this ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Not only has He given them the seal of the prophets, Nabiyuna Muhammad alayhi salatu wa salam, but He also gave this ummah and humanity indeed the final revelation and the Quran. And as we are in the last day of Ramadan, one, we should be delightful and joyful that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has allowed us to fast Ramadan, yet at the same time sad that we are leaving Ramadan. One, because of the blessings of Ramadan, but also because of not having the opportunity to listen to the Quran being recited every night. After the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abu Bakr and Umar radiyallahu anhuma went to visit Umm Salama. And when she saw them, she began to weep. And they stopped until she finished weeping, and they said to her, "What makes you weep? Ma yubkiki ya Umm Salama? What makes you weep? Don't you know that what Allah has bestowed or stowed for His Nabi, His Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the Akhirah, in the hereafter, is much better for what He gave him in this dunya?" She said, it's not about this that I'm crying. I know that what Allah will give the Prophet ﷺ is much better. I'm not crying about the fact that he passed away and that Allah will give him something better. They said, then why are you weeping? قَالَتْ عَلَى انْقِطَاعِ الْوَحِيِ I'm weeping because the revelation stopped. Revelation has stopped. There will be no more revelation, and Jibreel alayhi salam will not come to this earth anymore. So when she said that, she made them also weep. Abu Bakr and Umar wept at the fact that, yes, indeed, wahi is no longer revealed. And so we are given the opportunity to listen every night in Ramadan. My brothers and sisters, we ask Allah Azza wa Jal to accept the ta'at, the acts of obedience, inshaAllah ta'ala, and to, inshaAllah ta'ala, allow us tomorrow to celebrate Eid as it should be celebrated. And the beauty of our deen is that deen that is balanced. There are times when we have to be serious and times where we have to stand up long hours before Allah ta'ala in salah. But also Allah ta'ala gives us times when we have to be joyful and we have to bring happiness and delight in our lives and that of our children and families. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us about this in the Quran when He says, قُلْ بِفَضْلِ اللَّهِ وَبِرَحْمَتِهِ فَبِذَلِكَ فَلْيَفْرَحُوا It is because of Allah's virtue, grace and mercy upon you that you should be delighted and happy. In a sahih hadith in Bukhari, Qutaybah bin Sa'id, or Sa'id radiallahu anhu, says that Sahal bin Sa'ad said that we used to become very happy every Jumu'ah, the Sahaba, because often when we think of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, the companions, we think that they had a frown on their face and they never smiled all their lives. They were men, yes, the iman in their hearts was like mountains, and they were willing to do whatever it takes to please Allah Ta'ala and His Messenger, but yet they were also humans who were happy and smiled, and they were sad when they needed to be sad, and they were happy when they needed to be happy. And so in this particular hadith, this Sahabi says, every Jumu'ah, every Friday, because Jumu'ah is a Eid also for Muslims, we would be very happy. Especially because there was a woman, an old woman in town, who used to cook a special meal, and we would wait anxiously to go and eat from that meal. So we won't have lunch that day, nor do we have our qaylula or our nap after Jum'ah, but we rush to her house so we can eat from the food that she has cooked. And that would make us extremely happy. And so happiness and joy is a natural instinct, and it is a natural human disposition that we should not deprive ourselves from, nor should we deprive our families. Especially that Eid, alhamdulillah, is now on, that we must be mindful to bring happiness into our houses. Yes, indeed, the Ummah is suffering tremendously across the world, and that should be kept in perspective. Yet, we should also give Eid its haqq, its due right, and bring happiness into our houses. Aisha radiallahu anha, for example, tells us in a sahih narrated by Bukhari, قالت دخل أبو بكر وعندي جاريتان من جوار الأنصار تغنيان بما تقاولت الأنصار يوم بعاث قالت وليستا بمغنيتين فقال أبو بكر أمزامير الشيطان في بيت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وذلك في يوم عيد فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يا أبا بكر دعهما فإن لكل قوم عيد وهذا عيدنا. Aisha رضي الله عنها narrates a beautiful narration, and she gives us a depiction, a living story of the life of Rasulullah ﷺ from inside his own house. She says, I was in the house with the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم on the day of Eid, and we had two young girls or young ladies who were actually singing. But they were not professional singers. And they were singing words which were appropriate and recalling some of the days of the Arabs, but in a singing tone. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was sitting and he had his face away from them. But he did not stop them from doing so. Until Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu walked in. And when Abu Bakr walked in, he reprimanded them and wanted to stop them. And he says, the flutes of shaitan in the house of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, meaning, what are you doing? Stop this. And that is on a day of Eid. Then Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam turned to Abu Bakr and he said, oh Abu Bakr, leave them be. Let them continue. Every nation has a Eid and we have our Eid. We have our Eid. We have to make it a happy Eid, especially for our young people in this country, in a place like Australia, where for them Eid is more so about division within the community as to when is Eid or when Eid is not. Or Eid for our young people nowadays is a boring set of rituals that we have to attend, and after that there is no celebration. Eid for our young people nowadays, there is more excitement in the celebrations that other people have than the celebrations that we Muslims have. And in the guise of wanting to be pious and righteous, we deprive our community and deprive our families from the joy of Eid. We have to bring this joy into our lives and the lives of our children. And as Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam told Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, leave them. Let there be some joy in the house. Of course, it is the halal type of joy. And alhamdulillah, halal is quite wide. It is us who have restricted this deen and made our lives in many cases miserable. In another hadith in Bukhari, عن عدي بن ثابت قال سمعت عبد الله بن يزيد الأنصاري عن أبي مسعود الأنصاري فقلت عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه قال إذا أنفق المسلم نفقة على أهله وهو يحتسبها كانت له صدقة. Not only were they happy during the Eid, but they spent also on their families. So don't be a miser in this Eid. Spend on your families. It is a time when you can bring happiness into the lives of your families. Don't use the excuse that people across the world are suffering and therefore I'm going to make my family suffer here. Don't use the excuse that other people are not eating, therefore I'm not going to give my children a happy Eid. Make it a happy Eid for them, may Allah Ta'ala accept, and spend on them. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, if a Muslim spends anything on his family, then that is considered a sadaqah. It's a sadaqah. And sometimes sadaqah inside is better than outside. Often we think about giving only to those outside, and we forget about our own family. And we know of stories where men or family members are miser. They don't want to spend on their families. They don't want to spend on their children to make them happy. وعن علي بن أبي طالب رضي الله عنه قال من السنة أن تخرج إلى العيد ماشيا وأن تأكل شيئا قبل أن تخرج. And also of the Eid, to show the joy of Eid and the celebration of Eid, is to actually go to the Eidgah or to the place of Eid walking. As Ali radiallahu anhu reports that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he went to the Eid Salah, he went walking, and that you should eat something before you go to the Eid. والعمل على هذا الحديث عند أكثر أهل العلم يستحبون أن يخرج الرجل إلى العيد ماشيا وأن يأكل شيئا قبل أن يخرج لصلاة الفطر. It is the preferable opinion among the scholars that you walk towards the Eid place. Obviously, if it is not too far, then it is best to walk. And one of the reasons is to show that joy and happiness. As you are walking, you're making the takbir. And also to show people that Muslims are celebrating, and that we are not only about being in a state of sorrow and despair, but rather we have also our days of happiness. وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا خرج يوم العيد في طريق رجع من غيره. It is also narrated that whenever Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم went to Eid Salah, if he took one pathway or a certain way, when he came back, he tried to come back a different way. And of course, if it is only feasible and possible, then we should follow these sunan. These are beautiful sunnas of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And also in the Eid, especially Eid Salah, we must not use the excuse that women should not go out of their houses, because women should stay in the houses and women should not go and pray in Salatul Eid. Especially for Eid Salah, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made it and special emphasis in the ahadith that all, everybody should go for the Eid Salah. The men and the women, including women who are otherwise usually confined in their houses, they choose not to go out. But on Eid Salah, he says, they need to go out. And women who are menstruating even, he says they should also go. As Ummu Atiyya radiallahu anha qalat anna Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam kana يخرج الأبكار والعواتق وذوات الخدور والحيض في العيدين فأما الحيض فيعتزلن المصلى ويشهدن دعوة المسلمين قالت إحداهن يا رسول الله إن لم يكن لها جلباب قال فلتعرها أختها من جلابيبها. نبي صلى الله عليه وسلم or أمو عطية said نبي صلى الله عليه وسلم used to ask everybody to go to عيد صلاة. He used to ask women who were young and old, those who would otherwise be in their houses. He says, this is the time you go to the Eid Salah. And the women who are menstruating, meaning those who are not supposed to be making Salah or come to a masjid, but they should go there, but not be in the prayer rows, but should, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, so they can witness the dua of the Muslims and get the barakah of that dua. And then Ummu Atiyya asked a very interesting question. She said, oh Prophet of Allah, what if one of these women don't have a jilbab? She doesn't have clothes, proper clothes to wear to go to the Eid Salah. Meaning there is an excuse. He says, no, she should borrow some clothes from her friends or her sisters so that she can go to the Eid Salah. Because it is a time of celebration. Eid is a time where we can celebrate the bounties of Allah Ta'ala upon us. It is a time to show our gratitude towards Allah Ta'ala for allowing us, one, to fast Ramadan, and second, for the bounties of eating and drinking that He has given us. Not only this, the very fact that we are able to eat in itself is a bounty. The very fact that we are able to drink is a ni'mah from Allah that we take for granted. The very fact that we are able to digest the food that we eat is a bounty of Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. The very fact that we are able to get rid of the excess waste that Allah Ta'ala or that food in the body is a bounty from Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. We have to remember these bounties of Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. Of the joys of Eid is to wear beautiful new clothes also. In fact, it is a sunnah. فَيُسَنُّ فِي ثِيَابِ الْعِيدِ أَن تَكُونَ جَدِيدًا. Many ulama say it is of the sunnah that you wear new clothes for Eid, because you have to give it that joy. You need to bring that excitement in your life and the lives of people around you during the day of Eid. فَمَنْ لَمْ يَجِدْ ثَوْبًا جَدِيدًا لَبِسَ أَفْضَلْ مَا عِنْدَهُ مِنَ الثِّيَابِ. And if you can't buy a new cloth, if you can't buy new clothes, then wear the best clothes that you have. And again, some people use the excuse of zuhud, the excuse of being ascetic and detached from this world, the excuse that I have to be muttaqi and pious. And by piety, it means I have to show a sense of austerity and I have to look shaggy and disheveled. That is, in fact, contrary to the very idea of Eid. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, عن الزهري قال أخبرني سالم بن عبد الله أن عبد الله بن عمر قال أخذ عمر جبة من استبرق تباع في السوق فأخذها فأتى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال يا رسول الله ابتع هذه تجمل بها للعيد والوفود فرفضها رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لأنها من الحرير. نبي صلى الله عليه وسلم or عبد الله بن عمر says one day عمر رضي الله عنه, and what makes this hadith interesting is that it's عمر رضي الله عنه who is known for his firmness and strictness. Umar radiallahu anhu bought a jubba, a garment from the market, but it had brocaded with a golden brocade and it was made of silk. And he didn't know at the time that was prohibited, so he went, it was a beautiful garment. So he took it to Rasulullah sallam and he says, please take it as a gift and wear it during Eid, فَتَجَمَّلْ بِهَا. Beautify yourself, O Prophet of Allah, during Eid. And when envoys, when ambassadors come to meet you, or representatives of other nations come to see you, beautify yourself with it. He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, did not object to the idea itself of wearing new and beautiful clothes on Eid, but he rejected that particular garment because it wasn't halal, it was made of silk, which also should make us think that the clothes that we should wear should also be earned from a halal income. And it should also be halal in itself. So for men, for example, wearing silk is not allowed. Unless, of course, there is a medical reason where there is no other clothes that a man can wear but silk, otherwise he will be harmed. Then, of course, our deen, as I said, alhamdulillah, is vast and beautiful in this regard. قال ابن القيم رحمه الله تعالى وكان يلبس للخروج إليهما أجمل ثيابه. Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم used to wear the most beautiful clothes on the day of Eid. And he is Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. He did not use the excuse of zuhud, asceticism and detachment from this world, not to display the beauty that of the bounties that Allah gave him. And so he used to have, in fact, a special garment that he only wore in the two Eids and Jumu'ah, because he gave these occasions their weight, and he appreciated the fact that we need to wear beautiful clothes on the day of Eid. Of course, beautiful clothes does not mean they should be clothes that are going to create fitna. And this is particularly for our sisters. I know not so many of them are in the masjid, but if you were to take this message back, take it back nicely and softly. And that is, women, of course, should be dressed up also, but not in a way that is going to cause a fitna. And therefore, it is understood that any clothes that are tight and revealing, both men and women, not only women, any clothes that are tight and revealing should not be worn, because this is a day to celebrate the bounties of Allah Ta'ala and not a day to try to cause any type of fitna. And so it is important that our sisters, and indeed our brothers, to be dressed modestly so that they are gaining rewards on that day and not otherwise. قال ابن عابدين في رد المحتار. Ibn Abidin said, اعلم أن الكسوة أنواع. Know that wearing clothes are categorized in a number of ways. And one of those he mentioned, of course, is haram type of clothing. But also he talked about ومباح. There is the permitted type of clothing, وهو الثوب الجميل للتزين في الأعياد والجمع ومجامع الناس. And of that is the beautiful clothes that you can wear to beautify yourself when you're going for Eid Salah, or coming for Jum'ah, or when you are meeting people. لا في جميع الأوقات لأنه صلف وخويلاء وربما يغيظ المحتاجين إلى آخره. And of course, this type of beautification does not necessarily need to be on an everyday basis, but rather especially when we go for Eid, my brothers and sisters, is that we must give Eid its due and bring joy and happiness in the lives of our families and children, inshallah ta'ala. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. يا فوز المستغفرين استغفروه إنه غفور رؤوف رحيم. الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا فيه، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا، أما بعد. My brothers and sisters, it can be disappointing and disheartening to see that still, you know, some people fast on one day or have Eid on one day, and another group of the community have Eid on another day. To say the least, it's very sad, it's very unfortunate. And if anything, it is indicative perhaps of the failure in the leadership. And so we hope that this matter is resolved so that we can close this door of division and dispute among the community. However, we must not use the occasion to create further division in the community. And so the best that option, or the best opinion that we should adopt, is if others have decided to have Eid today, for example, we ask Allah Ta'ala to accept from them. If that is their choice, that is fine. And if others have decided to have Eid tomorrow, we ask Allah Ta'ala to accept, and we ask Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala to make it joyful and prosperous for them. And we must not make this issue, especially among the general masses, an issue of dispute and discussion, but rather we should raise this issue to the councils of imams and ulama, and in fact begin to exert some pressure to say to them that we cannot tolerate this type of division to continue, and we need to have a solution for this. Otherwise, we will continue perpetually to have this dispute. It is interesting, each Muslim country around the world, each Muslim country follows their own citing or follows their own opinion, and they don't look at other countries, but for us, for some reason, everybody wants to follow somebody else. And so perhaps, inshallah ta'ala, part of your dua is to make dua for the community to begin to at least unite on these issues, inshallah. But let's not make it an issue of dispute, and let's not make it an issue where we begin to disparage and think bad of others, but rather we say it is a matter, unfortunately, of difference of opinion at this stage, and we hope that it is resolved later. My brothers, part of Eid, as I said, is to give. And of course, you must not forget the Sadaqat al-Fitr or Zakat al-Fitr. Each one, each male and female, must pay the Fitr Zakah or Sadaqat al-Fitr before the Salah begins. And so we advise that you do it, in fact, today if you can. And I wasn't here when they decided the calculations, but I think it was $10, inshallah ta'ala, per person. So there are many ways that you can do so, either through some of the reputable organizations that we have, whether it's Muslim Aid or whether Islamic Relief or Muslim Charitable Foundation, or in the day there will be collections also. And so don't forget that, inshallah ta'ala. But also don't forget the fact that, as we said, spend on your family within your own measure and within your own capacity, and bring joy and happiness in your households, inshallah ta'ala. Sadaqah, my brothers, is something that we can invest and it never diminishes. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us in the Quran in Surah Sabah, وَمَا أَنْفَقْتُمْ مِنْ شَيْءٍ فَهُوَ يُخْلِفُهُ وَهُوَ خَيْرُ الرَّازِقِينَ. Whatever you spend for the sake of Allah ta'ala, whatever sadaqah you give, whatever money you give for the sake of Allah, He will recompensate you. Allah ta'ala is the best of those who recompensates. So we need to spend not only for those who are in need, but also on our own families, and also, importantly, for our own houses of worship. I have been in this masjid for at least 17 to 20 years, and almost every week, or if not every second week, there is a collection for some other masjid. And alhamdulillah, hundreds of thousands of dollars have been given to other masajid. And it wasn't until last week that we began a collection fund for this masjid. This is your masjid, and this is a masjid that has played an important role in the lives of Muslims and an important role in the lives of non-Muslims also, in trying to make them understand the beauty of this deen. And so, my brothers, I encourage you, and sisters, of course, to give, inshallah ta'ala, for the fixing and the reconstruction and the refurbishment of this masjid, inshallah ta'ala. And sisters should feel that they are part of this process. One of the things Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used to do after Eid Salah was actually go and address women specifically and ask them to give. And in some hadith it says, and women used to give the most. Women used to give the most. And don't be surprised by this. I know in some other masajid, when they were doing collection, they went to some houses, and some of the sisters whom you think they have no place, there is no position, they have no titles, they are not businesswomen, they don't have businesses, and some of these sisters gave checks of $100,000 for these masajid. And other sisters who had no money, except maybe $10 in their savings. I know of this for a fact because I was told this firsthand. A sister called one of those brothers and she said, all I have is $10 to give to a masjid, but I live 50 k's from where you are. Can you come and pick the $10? And the brother said, I did not want to say no to her because Although it is only $10, but I thought if I was to say no, what will I say to Allah Ta'ala on that day if He says to me, she said she wants to pay and you belittled that sadaqah. For we should never belittle any sadaqah, for indeed even half a date in sadaqah given sincerely for Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala could save a person from Jahannam on that day. Absolutely. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, ما نقصت صدقة من مال. صدقة never ever diminishes wealth. Logic tells us that the more you give of your money, the more it will diminish. Physically, yes. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes against that logic. And he says to us, you need to think of the unseen and you need to think of the metaphysical reality that is controlled by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You need to think that if you give for Him, He will multiply it. And that is why Allah ta'ala says that He increases sadaqat, He increases charity, and He diminishes riba. Although riba gives you the indication that your wealth is increasing, Allah says, no, I am diminishing it. Because you could have $1 million without barakah in it. And a man could have 1,000 only with barakah. And that 1,000 would do him much more than the man with 1 million. And not only in terms of its financial capacity, but also in terms of the barakah it may bring to his life or her life. And that is why we must be willing, inshallah ta'ala, to give without fear. وَمَا تُنْفِقُوا مِنْ خَيْرٍ فَلِأَنفُسِكُمْ. Whatever you spend of goodness, Allah Ta'ala says, is for your own selves. Allah Ta'ala doesn't need it. It is you spending it only to seek His pleasure, only so that He can give you an elevated position in the next life, inshaAllah Ta'ala. We will, inshaAllah Ta'ala, ask for more collections after Salah. So please, if you're not in a rush, stay back and take this opportunity, especially on this last day of Ramadan, when hasanat, good deeds are multiplied and giving for the house of Allah Ta'ala is even more multiplied. هذا عباد الله وصلوا على رسول الله فإن الله يأمر بذلك قائلا إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. يا أرحم الراحمين يا أرحم الراحمين يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم ربنا لك الحمد والشكر كما ينبغي لجلال وجهك وعظيم سلطانك. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك منك لا نحصي ثناء عليك أنت كما أثنيت على نفسك. اللهم إنا نسألك بأسمائك الحسنى وكلماتك التامة واسمك الأعظم وجدك الأعلى أن تغفر لنا ذنوبنا وتكفر عنا سيئاتنا يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم تقبل منا صيامنا وتقبل منا قيامنا وتقبل منا ركوعنا وسجودنا يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم تقبل منا تلاوتنا للقرآن العظيم وانفعنا بها يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم يا أرحم الراحمين إن ذنوبنا بلغت عنان السماء ولا يغفرها إلا أنت، فاغفر لنا مغفرة من عندك وارحمنا إنك أنت الغفور الرحيم. اللهم تقبل منا رمضان، اللهم تقبل منا صيام رمضان، اللهم تقبل منا صيام رمضان يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم إنا عبيدك بنو عبيدك بنو إمائك، نواصينا بيدك، ماض فينا حكمك، عدل فينا قضاؤك. نسألك اللهم بكل اسم هو لك سميت به نفسك أو علمته أحدا من خلقك أو استأثرت به في علم الغيب عندك أن تجعل القرآن الكريم ربيع قلوبنا وذهاب همومنا وغمومنا يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب. اللهم اغفر وارحم وتجاوز عما تعلم إنك أنت العز الأكرم. اللهم اغفر لنا ولوالدينا وللمؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات الأحياء منهم والأموات. اللهم ارحمنا وارحم والدينا وارحم المؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات الأحياء منهم والأموات. اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين، اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين، اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين. اللهم انصر إخواننا في فلسطين، اللهم انصرهم على أعدائهم يا أرحم الراحمين، اللهم ثبت أقدامهم، اللهم خذ بأيديهم وكن معهم يا أرحم الراحمين، اللهم وانصر كل من جاهد في سبيلك لإعلاء كلمة الحق يا أرحم الراحمين، اللهم كن معهم وثبتهم يا أرحم الراحمين. ربنا اهدنا واهدي بنا واجعلنا سببا وسبيلا لمن اهتدى. اللهم ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار، وصل اللهم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه الأخيار. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون، وسلام على المرسلين، والحمد لله رب العالمين.
رأيت الذنوب تميت القلوب ويقطعها وترك الذنوب حياة القلوب وخير لنفسك عصيانها. رأيت الذنوب تميت القلوب ويتبعها الذل إدمانها. وترك الذنوب حياة القلوب وخير لنفسك عصيانها.